travelled here from Australia, from my hometown of Perth, to be here with you tonight, to introduce somebody that I have only just met, really. I've only met this person today. For those of you who don't know me, I am a clinical nurse specialist. I have my own organisation in Australia where I go into workplaces and I check people for skin cancer. And I must see 20,000 people over my time. So I'm a health professional, I'm an author, I'm a researcher. And like many of you in the room tonight, I'm also an experiencer. So it's an absolute pleasure to spend this few moments with you. And I'm also proud to announce that Paula has invited me to talk next year, so I'll be able to share some of my experiences with you then, and that's exciting for me. Again, today I made this 15,000 kilometre journey to be here with you because I have something special that I need to be here for, and it's not the first time that I've been to Loughlin. Last time I was compelled to come here because I had a feeling that there was something important that I needed to do or needed to find out. And I had many questions that needed to be answered for me, and there were many life's experiences that didn't make much sense, but I needed to know. And after leaving here, I felt those questions were answered, and I had the clarity. In May this year, the month before May, I opened up my Facebook account, as you do, and on the feed there was information about an event that was going to take place in Mexico City. I had never, in my wildest dreams, thought that I would ever go to Mexico City. It wasn't somewhere that I had intended to ever go in my life, but I felt compelled to be there. So much to the point that within an hour I had booked my tickets and tickets for my friend, a friend of mine who felt the same way that I did about this event. So she and I travelled to Mexico City. Again, I didn't know what compelled me to be in Mexico. I thought it might have been her incredibly warm and welcoming people, the amazing culture, her architecture, the pyramids, the volcanoes. It might have been exploring the world's largest collection of Maya and Aztec artifacts, along with many interesting skulls, if any of you have ever been to Mexico. And also the Aztec calendar in the Mexico Anthropological Museum. However, I was to discover that the reason I had travelled to Mexico to be there on the 5th of May this year was something incredible. My friend and I had been to the museum all day, and it was raining and windy, and we walked across the avenue de la Reforma under our umbrellas in the stormy weather, and we took our place in the auditorium with many thousands of other people. These people came from all walks of life. There were men, women, older people, younger people, children. These people represented all aspects of the community, all socioeconomic standings, all religious, all beliefs. As I looked around me, I thought, you know, I'm very humbled to be here amongst these people, and it wasn't what I had expected to find in Mexico, I can tell you that. I was blown away by how sophisticated Mexico City is. It's amazing, and the people there. As we donned our headphones to hear the translation between English, sorry, we've got a bit of feedback, between English and Spanish, I listened for 6 hours as people from, I shouldn't say people, as scientists who were the experts in their field gave intricate details of anatomy and physiology, of zoology. biology, forensic science, mummification processes. These were traditional scientists, but they were experts in their fields. And they used a scientific approach, the scientific method to get to their conclusions and to present the conclusions as a white paper that could be reviewed by their peers. And anyone in the scientific community know how that important that is. In the final moments of that presentation, there was a holographic image of an extraterrestrial, of a person that the body represented. It was digitally reconstructed and measured, just as the archaeologists will reconstruct a mummy, a mummified body. And when I saw this person walk onto the stage, this amazing little person, I cried. I suddenly felt vindicated. And it wasn't just for me. I felt that all of us who have experienced something incredible, something that we can't explain to people, something that is tangible and real, something that's touched us and helped us feel, that we had been vindicated. And I thought the world will finally know the truth, because this is the truth. This is scientifically proven. It was one of the most poignant moments of my life. And I need to say, though, this story isn't about me. It's about the person that made this happen for me, for everyone that has experienced, for all of the disclosure people, for all of the brave men and women that have stood up the front and been ridiculed and humiliated to speak the truth. The person who made this happen for me and so many others around the world was someone who I saw was truly compassionate, one who cares about humanity and the condition of the human race. I saw a man who was desperate to improve the world, to provide mainstream science with the smoking gun. A reason to stop and say, what if? What if this is real? A reason to change their paradigm, a reason to look at things differently and to take science in a direction that it needs to be going in. Jaime Maussan, his passion for the truth has caused him to work tirelessly through the years to open the world's eyes to the UFO phenomena. His more than 40 years as a journalist has given him wisdom and insight to see through the skeptics so that he can report, as great journalists do, he can report the evidence that he feels will affect social change. 12 years ago, I had contact experience during which I was given a message, and I'd like to repeat that message for you all tonight. It's the first time I've ever spoken of this in public. I asked the visitors, when would they make themselves known to the world as a whole, and when would they accept us as ambassadors? And this was their response. You seek to be ambassadors to the universe. You must first seek to be ambassadors for yourself. How can you accept us? How can you accept our differences if you cannot accept each other's? Honour all life forms. Cherish those who are different, for difference is what enhances life. Seek not proof of life, but honour the reality of existence. See with your heart. Listen with your soul. feel with your knowing. Many are chosen, few will follow. Jaime Maussan is chosen. He did follow, and he has the courage to stand by his convictions. He is our ambassador to the universe. And ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Jaime Maussan.
Thank you. Thank you to Karen, very kind words. Yes, it was a splendid event. I am very proud we did it. It doesn't matter what they say after we did it. The evidence is right there, and someday will be discovered by science, and they will have to accept that the truth was said before, and that the truth will persist, will prevail. And that's all it matters. Thank you very much. As Karen said, I've been a journalist for the last 45 years of my life. I have a journalistic mind. I'm very skeptic in so many ways. But when something is proven, when something is really based on facts, we have to accept it. We cannot deny what is there. I've been trying to understand why this presence is on Earth, as everybody else, what it means, why they are here. And probably, because of what is happening right now in the world, I'm starting to understand. And I'm going to try to explain this reality, the evidence that I brought with me, that is probably somehow related to what is happening again. As you know, yesterday in France, there was an horrific event. Probably around 150 people died, killed, for no reason, more than to try to present a different position from people who believed in a different way about God. That is all. It's a religious war. And this war is possibly in the beginning to become the Third World War, as the Pope Francisco said this morning. Probably we are living through it. And probably this presence here has been trying to tell us that this is happening and it's going to happen if we don't do anything about it. That's why I'm going to start this presentation by remembering the Jerusalem sighting back in January 28th, 2011, just 3 days after the revolution in El Cairo started. This evidence, as we have investigated, is real. The UFO investigators in Israel think that this evidence or this event really happened. They have done their own investigation. And we were able to find a fifth video that proves that all of it is real. What do I mean with it? Okay, let's start with this presentation. And if we can lower the lights, it would be better probably. Just a brief word. This happened at the Dome of the Rock, which is considered the sacredest place probably in the world for the Jews, for the Catholics and for the Muslims. This was the first video recorded by Eligael Gejaldo Beach. The second video was recorded by his friend, we don't know the name, with a cellular phone. The third video was recorded by some students that were having a party in the outside of Jerusalem. They were having fun until they went to a place where they could see the city, and they saw this light just above the Dome of the Rock. The fourth video was recorded by a security camera in the Arab side of the city. By the way, when the UFO left, there were some signs in the sky. This is the fourth video. And now we were able to get the fifth video when my colleague Fernando Correa traveled to Jerusalem just a few weeks ago. We sync the fourth videos. This is the fifth video. What this means, if this is real, it has to mean something. We found at the Quran Chronicles that there is a prophecy about the Archangel Raphael, or Rafi, that says that the end of times would be announced by the Archangel Raphael, or Rafi, at the Dome of the Rock. The end of times, not the end of humanity. And it seems that this is what is happening right now. I want to take a look at this evidence that we have for a long time. This figure appeared in England, and it's something said something very important. Much pain, but it's still time. Much pain, but it's still time. And then it said, believe there is still good out there. Probably at that moment, we didn't understand what they were trying to tell us. Then, in 2008, we had this huge cross, 300 yards by 200 yards at Edgehampton, also in England. Then we had a second cross on the 24th of September, which is very, very late in the season. And then we even had a third cross with a message on the 28th of September 2008. What the message said? It said the words, beware, beware, to be alert, to watch out, to be careful. All that meanings are from this word, as you know. Then we have much pain, but still time. And now we have the word, beware, be alert, be careful. Then on July 30th, 2010, we have these two formations along the sides of the M4 highway in England. We found that they look like a face on the opposite way. Then we turn around one of them, we put them together, and then we found the face. It looked exactly as the face that we have in the Turin Trout. This is Christ. It seems to be a message to you. From then, we had many, many examples. I just brought three of them with me, of these crosses appearing in different parts of the world. Very recently in Ukraine, also in Crimean Peninsula. We have to remember too, the so-called home, the flutes of the apocalypse, as they are called, they started also in Crimea on August 11, 2011. There are so many examples, hundreds of examples. I just brought with me a few of the most recent ones. Put up the sound, please. The sound. I believe those sounds are trying to tell us something. And in Ukraine, the images are crying blood. This very strange formation was in a wall, looks like dead. We have this incredible sighting over Ukraine, in Kiev. All of this means something. Someone is trying to tell us something. And now with the last events, we probably can understand why. As you know, in Ukraine, this airplane crash just a year ago, a Malaysian Airlines, and right there we have now sightings in Donetsk, exactly in the same place where this airplane crashed. Just very recently in Donetsk, we had these incredible sightings. It is just amazing what is happening in Ukraine and especially at the Sevastopol Peninsula. Why Sevastopol? I mean the Sevastopol Crimea, the peninsula of Crimea. Sevastopol is a Russian base, a military base, and there, since 2011, we have very important sightings, like what we can see in this photograph taken right there at Sevastopol. I believe they are trying to attract the attention, or they are very curious about something that is happening there. The other possibility is that there is something under the sea, the Black Sea. This face appeared in Sevastopol too. It looks again like Christ. In the last few months, we had incredible sightings at Sevastopol, like 19th of December 2014. Probably at this moment is the more important hotspot in the world. This is August the 9th, 2015.
Переливаются всеми цветами.
What is that? I don't know what is that.
Переливаются всеми цветами.
Да. But it just happened in Houston a few weeks ago. I present you this just as a comparison. March the 30th, 2015. I never seen anything like this. Let's continue with Sevastopol, this sighting over the Black Sea, very, very clear. I want to thank my colleague Santiago Iturria for all the hard work he's been doing with the Russians. He's been receiving directly these videos from Crimea. This is October the 6th in Sevastopol, 2015. You can clearly see this very impressive sighting. This is the Black Sea. 1 million years ago, it was a lake. But then the Mediterranean Sea inundated the waters of this lake, and it became the so-called Black Sea. This is Cabo Fiolent. And in Cabo Fiolent, we have very interesting evidence like this photograph that where you can see what it looks like a sphere like this one. They fly very close to the sea and they go inside the sea. In this case, it's a video. Is this a fisherman taking this video with his camera? As you can see, the sphere goes inside the water, floats, and then goes down. Let's watch it again. As you see now, it's going inside and takes a dip. This is again in October in Sevastopol. We have the same kind of sphere at night. This is above the water. These spheres are bright at night, and they are solid during the day. Now, let's see, this is with Google Earth. I was in Sofia, Bulgaria, just a week ago, presenting a conference there, and this scientist, Philip Pop, told me, have you seen Google Earth? Have you seen the Black Sea from Google Earth? And I say, no, why? Because I found something extraordinary. What he found were these lines that are 100 kilometers long. And he chose this line, which is very long, from the coast. And then he found this. He enlarged this for us. We made a close-up. We go inside. As you can see, it's a large structure, probably a city, or probably something under the sea. We have this line from the coast to that place, and we continue having sightings like this is from the 5th of November, 2015. This is very clear. I have many, many videos from Sevastopol. This is just a sample of what is happening there. But I believe they are trying to attract our attention to something that is going to happen or is happening already in Sevastopol. As you remember, on October 25th, 2012, we had this sighting at the volcano Popocatépetl. This was recorded with two different cameras, the scientist cameras and the television, the network where I work. They have a camera, and they were able to see this object going inside. 2 days after that, we have these spirals in three different radars, meteorological radars. The one from the Weather Channel, the one from the NOAA, and the one from the National Meteorological System of Mexico. In this one, which is from the Weather Channel, we can clearly see on the right side the hurricane Sandy going to New York. It happened at the same time. This is very graphic, and we can see how these are real messages. We can see these spirals moving exactly as the hurricane, but we didn't understand that until now. What I'm trying to explain here is that these intelligences try to inform us of things that are happening or are going to happen. You see, this is from the National Meteorological System of Mexico, and they were probably trying to warn us. This is from NOAA. Look at the movement of this, and it's exactly like a hurricane. But I didn't understand that then. Why the UFOs go inside the crater and create this, probably this kind of energy coming from the ground that it's observed by the meteorological systems. At that moment, we were trying to relate this to crop formations and other things. We didn't probably understand what was the meaning of this until just a month ago. Okay, now we have these objects going very near the volcano. This tubular object. This is the same video recorded with a scientific camera. It's not the same quality, not the same resolution. Just to prove that the sightings are real, both at the same time. And then we have this for May the 30th. 2013, again the UFO going inside the crater. Why this UFOs use the volcano. Now we know that this volcano produces the largest storms, magnetic storms on the world. Well, it happened again on October the 7th. It looks like a UFO went inside, and then we had again the same kind of event. We have again the spiral. We have again the message. And what happened? Just a few days after that, less than 5 days after that, we had the biggest hurricane ever hitting Mexico, Hurricane Patricia. It's the strongest hurricane ever. And guess what? Nothing happened. The Mexican president said it's because of the fate of the Mexicans and the world to stop this phenomenon. And probably that's what they were trying to warn us, to tell us something very extraordinary is gonna happen and you have to get together. And that's what we did. For no reason more than try to stop this for hurting people. We have now the same kind of activity around the fire volcano in Colima. All these videos have been recorded with scientific cameras. It's not with my cameras. These are the cameras from scientists and people who takes photographs from this volcano. We have again this presence near the volcanoes, probably because of the magnetic energy. As you know, changing the subject, that the aerial security is being compromised by this presence. I think it's accidental, but it means that we have to be very careful too. You know, it's been six times that the airports in China and Mongolia have been closed because of the presence of UFOs. It happened in Germany 2 years ago, and it happened in India just a few weeks ago. All these airports have been closed because these UFOs go very near the airplanes. Like in this case, this was taken with a telescope in Italy. The airplane is more than 10,000 meters, 30,000 feet, and we can see this UFO going very near. We have these pictures from Guadalajara. And we can see that they are very near the airplanes. In this case, we have five photographs. We can see the object going under the plane, going to the back of the plane, and then coming back faster than the airplane. They are watching us. You can see here this UFO going faster than the airplane. This is for March this year. We can see this sphere going very near this airplane, flying near Mexico City. At least five objects flew very, very near this airplane. That was the fifth. I presented this photograph a year ago here from Vegas, where Jaime Diaz was able to photograph this UFO invisible to the eye. But thanks to the sun, we were able to see it in these three photographs. I am presenting this again because it happened again.
Lato destro del Palazzo Verde.
We think this is the same kind of UFO. This was recorded by Antonio Ursi.
Ce l'hai la videocamera mia dietro?
Last year in Italy.
E cazzo.
In Milan.
Vabbè, dai, fai vola e vedi un po' se riesci a filmarlo.
We can compare that. And we can see that a Mexican couple, who was visiting Las Vegas on November the 9th, 2014, were able to photograph the same object, flying very, very low. All these videos that I'm presenting you are UFOs invisible to the eye. The only way we can see that is through the infrared. This video was recorded by my team at the volcano Popocatépetl and was invisible to the eye. They didn't see it, but the camera recorded this very near them and was very large. And they are here. Their presence is very, very intense, and we don't see it.
Oh, the two moving lights! Holy shit, let me just adjust this. Oh, man. Holy shit, look at that. Look at him, they're like completely moving. I don't know.
You have to remember that all these objects are invisible to the eye. And that way they can be here investigating us, and we don't see them. With these videos, we can see, for example, this sphere chasing a boat. This was in Sweden. We can see this sphere chasing a car in Argentina near Capilla del Monte. And we can see these lights chasing trains in Russia. Are so close to us, taking a look at our airplanes, chasing our cars, our boats, the airplanes. As I say, they also chase planes, follow airplanes, normally in the back, in the tail, where the pilots cannot detect them or see them, even the people in the airplane. This is here in California, and we see this same thing again. This was photographed in Mexico, two spheres chasing an airplane. I want to change the subject now. As you know, this star, KIC 8462852, which is light years away. It's a star. that was found that a huge mega structure is orbiting the star.
And this?
This is Michio Kaku at CBS.
This could be the biggest story of the past 500 years, bigger than the discovery of America by Columbus. This star is breaking all the rules. We have to rewrite astronomy textbooks. Basically, if a planet eclipses the mother star, goes in front of the mother star, starlight drops by maybe 1% at maximum. However, starlight has been dropping at 22%. There is a colossal, humongous object of some sort blocking the starlight from this star. We're talking about what is called a Type II civilization that could build a gigantic sphere, perhaps bigger than Jupiter, to absorb starlight. And this, of course, is right out of science fiction, but here we are staring at it, and we have no logical explanation other than to assume that perhaps, just perhaps, it's made by a civilization a few thousand years more advanced than ours, like the Federation of Planets.
They take us back to this evidence of huge spheres taking energy from our sun, as recorded by the Solar Dynamic Observatory back in 2012, where we see these huge stars, but not far away, in our sun. It means that this civilization Type II is probably nearest to us that we have ever thought. A civilization Type II can take all the energy from our sun. They can also consider to live forever. They are a civilization that can control all the elements in their planets and travel wherever they want. Are these creatures the ones that are trying to communicate with us? Trying to tell us something? This is new evidence. This was recorded in August 2014, near the Churyumov-Gerasimenko comet. We have to remember that the probe Philae was released by Rosetta in November. This video is from August. This video was recorded by the European Space Agency. Why? Why nobody has said anything about this? This is really clear, and this is not explainable. It seems that this object was then photographed standing on the surface of the comet Churyumov-Gerasimenko, a comet that has so many mysteries, as you know. It seems that it has water, it has all the elements for life. What is this object doing there? These are the sounds that this comet produces. We have to remember the monolith in the moon Phobos. Nobody has answered, what is that? Or nobody has answered, what are the lights in Ceres? Ceres is a planetoid, the biggest planetoid in our solar system. It is in the belt asteroid, and they have found these lights inside this crater. As you can see, they are bright at day and night. These lights are unexplainable. They are not volcanoes, they are not ice, they are not any kind of activity. They have found water, vapor of water above that lights. And NASA doesn't know what this means. It means probably that we have a base, a proven base, in one of our worlds in this solar system. And just on November the 7th, the Space International Station was able to photograph again something that it doesn't look like a natural thing. This was very near the International Space Station. As you know, the Vatican, as Danny Sheehan explained, is now analyzing very closely the possibility that life exists in other planets. Okay, in the year 2000, Dwayne Snyder found an ice meteorite in front of his house in South Haven, Michigan. He kept the samples of this meteor of ice and sent them to be analyzed, and they found all kinds of extremophilous life. Extremophilous life that has not been identified. And this ice meteorite can come from Enceladus, one of the moons of Saturn. It means that very soon the scientists are going to find many samples of life in our solar system, not just on Mars, that is just about to happen, but also in the moon Europa, around Jupiter, and in the moon Enceladus, around Saturn. Then Chandra Vikramasinghe, who is a scientist, the head of the astrophysical department, astrobiological department at the Buckingham University, found a meteorite with very old algae, diatomea. It means too that there are meteorites that prove that this kind of life is very probable in many other bodies in our solar system. This is just a brief collection of different subjects that prove, I believe, that we are being visited, we are being observed, and besides that, they are trying to tell us something. I think we are in the brink of a world war, or we have a chance, if what Danny Sheehan told me becomes truth, to change the position of the church related to the presence of these intelligences, of the presence of life in the universe. Now, if you allow me, I want to talk about what Karen was trying to explain at the introduction here. In May the 5th, 2015, I presented this body in Mexico City. A body and a placard. We can see a woman in the back. This was photographed with a Kodachrome slide, with a camera and a Kodachrome slide. There were two pictures. This is slide number 11, and the other is the slide number 9. One of them probably with a flash and the other without a flash, or probably the exposition was wrong in one of them. But it's the same body in both of them. They were taken by this couple, Hilda and Bernard Ray. He was the president of the engineers, the oil engineers in Texas. She was a lawyer and also she was a pilot, and they were very good friends, according to our investigations, to the Eisenhowers. These two slides were found in a box, hidden, and they were found too. There were many, many slides from the time where we can see Clark Gable and Bing Crosby, and we can see President Eisenhower taken from very close. These pictures were analyzed and we found that they were from 1947 to 1949. And we found many other reasons to believe they were from that time inside the pictures, in the other slides. There were many analyses.
And you are the...
Then what I did before presenting this in Mexico was to take these slides to this man. His name is Eleazar Benavides, and he is the last survivor from Roswell, from the witnesses that were inside that hangar
who can tell us
in Roswell. And this is the interview I made to him. You have to remember, he is the only one who saw the creatures from Roswell.
If this is close to what you saw, this is the creature you saw.
It is very
close. And we need your statement about this, because it's the only time that would be really ratified or certified something like this. That is why it's so important.
Well, let me say it very clearly that this does resemble very, very much what I saw. With the only exception that at that particular time some of these creatures were still alive. And like I say, why in the heck they put them in the hangar, I'll never know. That was beyond my control.
For the world and for history, you say this is it.
Yes. I think that you people got some good evidence that I lack, that you have. And I think either people have given the opportunity at the time, it could have been better for all of us to know about it. But some of the things that you all came out, I wouldn't ask you where you got them, but they come pretty close, very, 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 very close.
Then I interview, after having the testimony of the only witness alive that was there and saw this slide and telling me that this is real, then I tried to find experts to tell me what they thought about this. And I couldn't find a single expert in the United States who wanted to talk about this, even without seeing the slides. Then I found Richard Doble, an anthropologist and a specialist in Canada, and I presented the picture to him, and this is what he told me.
Is not a human being. This is not a reptile. This is not anything like that. It's not a mammal. It is something very strange from somewhere else. But the structure is very different. So none of this, even on the surface, this seems like a human being or some relative of ours. It's nothing like this. The closest thing we have in science to this is what's called convergent evolution. The classic case being a dinosaur, the ichthyosaur, my enunciation's not too good today, and the ichthyosaur looks just like a modern dolphin. It's got a snout, it's got a dorsal fin, it's got a tail, it's got a great big chunky body full of muscle, and it's got flippers. And that existed 145 million years ago. Then 20 million years ago, the first modern porpoise appeared, and it looks just like a modern porpoise. And it's got the snout, the dorsal fin, the tail. But you start looking and comparing, and the superficial realities of it are completely different. The dinosaur has back flippers as well as front flippers. And if you look at the dinosaur, it doesn't have fingers for flippers. The porpoise does. The dinosaur is nothing but a great big mass of carpal bones. And you look at everything else, the eye is somewhat different. The vertebral column is radically different than ours. And the reason for this convergent evolution is that two organisms from very different backgrounds inhabit roughly the same environment and maximize their adaptation to this environment. So an ichthyosaur and a dolphin, they're designed to be very successful fish-eating machines. So this creature is a lot like us. We're not sure just how, but it did not evolve from us. It's not a mammal because there's no hint of mammary glands and there's no hair. There may be some other mammalian traits. It's not a primate. It has a number of primate traits like binocular vision, and it's probably a very social animal, but we can only guess at that. It's got a couple of R traits. It's got a great big brain, and it's bipedal, and that makes us a hominid, but we're not related. We're not, it's not a mammal even. It's not a reptile, I mean, or a bird. The pelvis just doesn't match anything. So anybody who attempts to claim that this is somehow from Earth is really missing it.
No tengo nada que ocultar, al contrario, estoy...
This is Jose Salce. Can we put the sound up a little bit, please? This is the head of the forensic department of the Navy in Mexico. He's a young man. He was in the auditorium, and I had an interview with him afterwards after we were being attacked, and I asked him if he had changed his mind after the placard read that this was a two-year-old boy.
Abierto al diálogo, al debate y a la argumentación científica o a la ampliación del mismo.
Es decir, que para ti esto sigue siendo algo que no parece ser humano.
Definitivamente que no. Tiene tantas anomalías, tiene tantas alteraciones, tiene tantas irregularidades en los huesos, en su composición, en las articulaciones, que para mí difícilmente podría ser coexistente a la vida humana conocida.
Además, uno de los factores más importantes es que no tiene glándulas mamarias.
Definitivamente ahí tenemos dos alteraciones de tipo evolutivo. La primera, al no tener glándula mamaria, tetilla o pezón, no es un mamífero, y al no tener una cadera, una pelvis bien desarrollada con los tres huesos básicos que son el pubis, el ilion y el sacro no lo podemos ver, pero dos de tres no aparecen, no puede ser un primate.
El número de costillas.
El número de costillas es una alteración irrefutable, tiene entre 6, 7 máximo costillas, no tiene una clavícula, no tiene una articulación normal del hombro, del codo, de la rodilla, difícilmente podría ser compatible con un ser humano normal.
¿Podría ser un niño de 2 años de edad?
Por la estatura que tiene, no. Definitivamente no puede ser un niño de 2 años de edad. La estatura, el crecimiento que tiene de 1,20 m, 120 centímetros, no es compatible con un niño de 2 años de edad que está sobre los 70 centímetros alrededor, poco más, poco menos. Recordemos que el desarrollo, la estatura, tiene mucho que ver con la raza, con el tipo de alimentación, medio ambiente, genético, los padres, etcétera. Pero vaya, crecer a esas dimensiones, ni siquiera los que tienen acromegalia, gigantismo, llegan a tal desarrollo. Y todavía peor, si padeciera de esta enfermedad, entonces, ¿por qué la anormalidad del hueso del fémur, que es el hueso más grande?
¿Y la cabeza?
La cabeza, que está totalmente desproporcionada, tiene una macrocefalia severa, tiene una amplitud del ancho de los hombros y un largo del tamaño del tórax y un poco más allá, totalmente incompatible con cualquier ser humano
conocido. ¿Un niño a esa edad tendría todavía los huesos separados?
Bueno, las suturas de los cráneos se cierran aproximadamente a los 18 meses. Esto ocurre entre el año y los 2 años de edad. A veces puede tardar, insisto, por el tipo de medio ambiente, pero para un niño de 2 años prácticamente ya se encuentra en su cierre total. Por lo tanto, las características que presenta este cráneo está plenamente osificado. Si quisiéramos ser muy acuciosos, muy presuntuosos en la observación, podríamos ver que sobre la línea media de la frente tiene un borde saliente que se llama sutura metópica. Y eso nos determina claramente que es un hueso osificado al 100% y determinaría que sería un cráneo de un adulto, no de un niño de 2 años.
A pesar de lo que pueda decir la placa.
A pesar de lo que pueda decir la placa, sí. Para mí la evidencia principal recae sobre el cuerpo. La evidencia es el cuerpo. Un indicio, la placa. Pero un indicio no puede argumentarse con tanto valor hasta que se compruebe al 100%.
Y en este caso el cuerpo sería pues la evidencia más importante.
Sí, el cuerpo es lo más importante que hay dentro de la investigación forense.
These are the experts, and this is the picture that we were able to reconstruct. It took us more than 3 months to create this image, and it is exact from the body. This is a forensic reconstruction. After we did all of this, we analyzed and we did everything, somebody was able to find what the placard said, a mummified body of a two-year-old boy. And then, from the very beginning, I didn't accept this placard because the size of this creature was not of a two-year-old. We did many analyses, and we took everything that was inside the slide, like the placard itself. The size of the placard was considered to be 14 inches. It means that this creature had at least 47 inches, which is the size of a seven-year-old, or 1 meter and 20 centimeters. Then this was not a two-year-old. We took the holes in the bar, and according to the holes in the bar, it was the same size, 1 meter and 20 centimeter, 47 inches. And then we took the size of the woman that was there, and we measured that too. And again, it was consistent, 1 meter and 20 centimeters. These people said that this was a mummy found by S.L. Palmer, or L.S. Palmer, excuse me, back in 1896 in Montezuma Castle. We were able to find the real picture of this finding, and this is what Mr. Palmer found. We found the papers establishing this finding as official, and everything is there. And also, all the details that the arrows and the pottery that was found near the body, confirming this. And we have also found this document that saying that this body was 29 inches long instead of the 47 inches that we have with this body. Why is this so important? Because it proves that the placard is wrong. They presented these slides proving that this was the same kind of body. If you can clearly see, if you see closely, you will see many differences between the three bodies. You don't see the hand in the two first, you perfectly see the hand, and you see the elbow, the knee, and all the details in the first two pictures. You don't see the details in the third one. I don't want to go into too much detail, but these are different bodies. By the way, Karen took these pictures in the stage, and this came out from, she just showed me today these pictures from the stage in the auditorium in Mexico. I was surprised. I don't know what you see there, but it seems like a presence. It seems something extraordinary that was in the auditorium that day that nobody saw. Nobody saw.
We are getting closer. The increase in the occurrences of an alien presence around the world suggests the existence of an agenda, a plan. It is difficult to determine whether this approach is motivated by our development, our technology, or by their concerns about major changes that we are creating in our world. It is clear that we will face enormous challenges in the coming years. Overpopulation, the mass extinction of species, climate change, pollution in all parts of the world, are some of the great dangers that humanity will face in the process of evolution towards the development of a society more just and sustainable. Towards a society that will be able to live in harmony with itself and with its environment. Now we know that there are millions of worlds like ours just in our own galaxy. Life develops and persists in the most extreme environments. Today it's impossible not to see that in all worlds there is a form of life. Not all life develops, but when the conditions are right, it thrives and develops intelligence. Intelligent life evolves until finding its permanence and sustainability, then moves on to develop the technology for building a complex society that attains the knowledge which allows them to travel freely to the farthest corners of the universe. A society that is able to overcome inequality and disease. These are beings that can prolong their existence for centuries or millennia. They can reach other worlds to bring the good. Only good allows this level of development. Only creative societies survive, persist. Only they can go on and advance. Maybe they represent themselves as divine beings, bringing their expertise to others. The examples in our world and in our history prove it. The visitors are waiting for us. They wait day when we find our way of true spiritual development. The day when we can truly understand that sustainability can only be achieved through kindness and love. We have a long way to go. Yet we will have to face our mistakes and learn that only united, hand in hand, we will find the true meaning of our existence and then return to God. And we will find the paradise we have always dreamt of. For now it is possible to think that our descendants will have that opportunity and that they will reach heaven and understand the divine will.
Thank you very much.